Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Gage Hill Crafts. I'm Sarah Scully, your host. And today I wanted to tell you about one of my favorite summer treats. Now that the weather has gotten nice and warm, we've seemed to have skipped straight from winter into summer here in Vermont, and it's been about 80 degrees this week. And so it's the perfect time to make iced coffee. I love to drink coffee. I used to be actually a really big coffee drinker and probably drink too much coffee, but I've ratcheted myself back in the last couple of years, and I only have one or two cups a day. But in the summertime, this is something I absolutely love. And I like to make my own cold brew coffee. One of the reasons, the main reason, is that buying cold brew these days is really expensive if you get it from your local cafe. The good news is that, you know, it's really caught on as a trend, and I think a lot of cafes have gotten better at making it in-house. So I still buy it every once in a while when I'm out somewhere. But I found that making it at home is very easy and saves a lot of money. I probably pay a tenth, something like that. You know, a cold brew like this at a cafe would probably cost $4 or $5, depending on where you live. And I'm sure I can make this for less than 50 cents worth of coffee. So to make cold brew, there are now a lot of different systems on the market. There's probably tons of, you know, YouTube instructional videos on how to do it at home. And you don't even really need specialized equipment. You can probably use what you have on hand, you know, some mason jars, some coffee filters. But a lot of those kind of homegrown methods that I've seen kind of make a big mess. You have to use a lot of different containers. You have to filter stuff. I'm kind of a klutz when I'm in the kitchen, so I'm often like spilling things. And if I have to pour stuff to different containers, I usually end up making a big mess. And you know, even some systems that I found online, I just did a little research to kind of refresh my memory on what's out there on the market. And even some of those systems have you pouring, you know, awkwardly through some kind of homemade filter or something like that. And it just doesn't look like it would work for me. You know, again, if you don't want to spend a bunch of money on a cold brew system, that's completely fine. And I'm sure you can use some materials that you have on hand. For me, it was worthwhile to get an inexpensive cold brew system, and I bought, this is half of it right here, this is the brewing part of it. I bought this system back in 2015, that summer, and it served me very well. This system is made by a company called Toddy, and I'll link to them in the show notes. And you know, it's okay. It works really well. I haven't had any problems using it. And the way that it works is you put the ground coffee in this sort of plastic bucket, and this part sits over their carafe so that, you know, the carafe is down here and this sits on top, and then you let it brew for a day or two, and then you pull the plug, that it comes with, and that drains. And it drains through a reusable filter. This is a fiberglass filter, and you can see I've been using it quite a bit. I may need to change this out at some point, but I liked that the system came with reusable filters rather than having to use buy coffee filters or buy muslin bags or something else to filter your coffee. So this does a really good job. There's no like sludge in the bottom of the cold brew carafe on the last pour, which I really like. Sometimes you can get this stuff, it's almost like the sludge in the bottom of Turkish coffee, and it can be really strong and bitter. So I like that this really dense fiberglass filter does a good job of getting rid of all the fine particulate matter in the coffee grounds. But what I don't like about this system is, you know, it's got a lot of parts, it's kind of bulky. Half of it's made out of plastic, and as we all know, there's a big campaign out there in the world to kind of get as many plastics out of our lives as we can, and reduce that, you know, bad impact on the environment, both for making them out of petroleum products, and then, you know, half the time plastic stuff ends up in the ocean. So I didn't like that this was, you know, sort of sitting in plastic, and you can see the inside of it's stained, because sometimes plastic's hard to clean and it does stain easily. So if I had my choice today, I would probably get the system that's similar to something like the Beverage system. This is an all-in-one carafe. It comes with a stainless steel filter that sits down inside the carafe. You put your coffee in that, and then when you're finished letting your coffee brew, you just pull that filter out, and your carafe is ready to go with your coffee concentrate. You know, it's all glass and steel with a little bit of rubber. There's no plastic, and it's a more compact system as well. I think the only downside to that is sometimes I do want to make a lot of coffee concentrate to get me through a whole week, and I think you would have to brew a little bit more frequently with some of these smaller carafe-based systems because they just won't hold as much liquid. And again, I'm sure you can find more information about brewing iced coffee, but here's how I do mine. I like to leave my iced coffee out for a long time to let it really brew and make a coffee concentrate. So I don't drink the stuff that I make, the jet fuel that I make, straight out of the carafe. I water it down quite a bit because I make it very strong, and that's more economical. And it also means that I can make one batch that'll last me all week. So the way that I do this is I brew about a third of a pound of coffee at a time. I take, I always buy whole bean coffee and we grind it at home. And I have a coffee grinder it's a pretty good one. And it will do a very coarse grind. So you want the coarsest setting that you can get. If you're grinding it in the store using their coffee grinder, just set it on coarse. And then, like I said, you want to use about a third of a pound of coffee and about 3 cups of water or so, cold water. You're going to put that into whatever vessel you're using to do your brew. Give it a good stir. Make sure you've got your grounds really moistened thoroughly. There aren't any clumps of dried coffee in there. And then I like to let mine sit out for a full 48 hours. So if I want coffee for the weekend, I'm probably brewing on a Wednesday. If I want coffee for the week, I'm probably brewing like starting at Friday night so that it's ready Sunday night, and then I can have it on Monday. So you do have to plan ahead a little bit, but I find that it's really worth it. And that 48 hours of time really gives the coffee a long time to brew. The other thing that I do to get all the goodness out of the coffee grounds is that I then rinse the coffee grounds with another cup of water. So on this system, you would have the filter in the bottom beforehand, like that. And then you would put your coffee in, put your cold water, give it a good stir, let it sit, and then pull your plug out, right? Let this drain into your carafe, and then pour another cup of cold water over the grounds, give it another stir, and let that drain into your carafe as well. You might have to adjust the amounts of water depending on how much your carafe will hold, but what this will do is rinse those coffee grounds and get the rest of the cold brew that's kind of stuck in the filter, get the rest of that good coffee essence to come down into the carafe. That is, like I said, very, very strong. I usually water down that coffee concentrate at least 2-to-1 with water, and then add quite a bit of milk. I like a nice milky iced coffee on top of that. So 1/3 coffee, 1/3 water, 1/3 milk is how I make my iced coffee. And you can play around with those proportions and see what you like. I will caution you that because iced coffee is so much more mild than hot brewed coffee in terms of the acidity and the bitterness, you might not notice that you've made yourself an intensely strong cup of coffee until you've had it and you've ingested it, and then you realize, oh, I just had a huge shot of caffeine. So if you're not used to drinking cold brew, go easy, water it down maybe a little bit more than you need to, and then you can refine it from there. The other great thing about brewing this coffee concentrate is that you can use it for other things. So not just making cold brew, you can heat up a cup of cold brew coffee and have a very nice hot coffee. So if you want to offer guests an option of cold or hot, you could just make a batch of cold and then heat up the coffee concentrate and make hot coffee. The other thing that I like to do is use this coffee concentrate for baking, especially like chocolate cake, where you would put some coffee in. It's so nice to have a coffee concentrate where you don't have to water down your batter too much, but you still can get a nice coffee undertone that complements the chocolate flavors from the cocoa. And the other thing, and my husband has done this, is use the coffee concentrate in brewing. And again, a little can go a long way. You don't have to mess with your water amounts in your brew as much, but you can get a nice intense coffee flavor if you're looking to make something like a coffee stout or an oatmeal stout with a, you know, more coffee undertone, something like that. It really can give you a nice intense flavor that's not bitter and isn't too acidic. Yeah, so using coffee concentrate is really great in cooking as well as just making refreshing cold brew. So I hope that you will try your own cold brew if you enjoy that as much as I do. And let me know what system you have or what method you use. I'm always looking for other tips and other ways to do things, especially if they save time and effort. Thanks again for joining me. And next week we are going to have a brew recipe. Speaking of brewing, we're going to be brewing a beer with the homebrew guru, Scott Russell. And we're going to be sharing the recipe on our newsletter. So if you haven't signed up for our newsletter, you can get to that in the show notes as well. And it's, you know, really low mileage on the newsletter. We only send about one message a month. But as an incentive, we want to share a Vermont-based beer recipe with you, and we hope you'll join us for that. So stay tuned for next week. We'll give you a little sneak peek. We're actually going to brew the recipe here, and we'll give you some information, and then you can sign up and get the recipe. Thanks so much for joining me, and have a great week.